But maybe that's part of the design of the SU-122. He got so lucky and everything was missing it because the profile was so low. One of the nice things about these Soviet tank destroyers is that they're turretless and their profile is so low that they're really damn hard to hit, even from reasonable ranges. That Panther and that PAK-40 had a really hard time hitting it because of its low profile. Something's on fire in the middle. I just missed what caused that. I assume it was like a flamethrower or whatnot. But more things are exploding, people are dying, it's Armageddon, and it looks like, whoa, the game's over. No, it's not over, he was just checking his score, what am I thinking? Okay. Like I said, the layout of this game, it's kind of stereotypical for no refund games. It's basically coming in tiers. He brings out a Panzer IV-E, that opponent brings out a counter, and then he brings out a bigger tank, which is a Panther. And that's something that I don't really like about no refund, because it's not as dynamic or crazy. Because in a game, in a refund game, people are more likely to do crazy things like have light tanks or a flank around a tank, flank around a heavy tank like a King Tiger IS-3, or even buy 10 light tanks. That's something I've tried before with Japanese and it actually worked. There was an enemy Pershing that was being annoying, so I built about 8 Japanese light tanks and just right-clicked the Pershing. About half of them died on the way, but the one or two who survived managed to shoot out the Pershing's treads and take it out. So you see, they're more likely to see crazy, interesting strategies and no refund, which is why I like it. I like being unpredictable and just a little bit off the hook. So, this game's relatively mellow. Looks like the person, what FrozenLiquidity is floating a lot of resources. He has 111 points that he hasn't spent yet, but he's saving up probably for something in case his opponent gets something bigger. And that's yet another thing I don't like about no refund, because it rewards people for saving their money and waiting instead of fighting. And that's not as fast-paced and dynamic as just using the resources you have and making the best of it. Man, I really turned this shoutcast into a petition for why a refund is better than no refund. Didn't really intend to do that, but now you know my position on things. But there is something crazy going on right now. There's an armored car. I really love those. Okay, so he's killing his infantry behind enemy lines. And, oh man, he just friendly fired all his infantry with that artillery shell. That's an argument against blobbing, don't blob. And that's an argument against crappy communication. He should have let his teammate know that he's had people coming and whatnot. So that's two lessons in one. But that armored car quickly got shot down. He basically put clicked his oh shit button and got out an anti-air tank to take out his armored car. Those armored cars are really nice. They're fast, they're small, they're cheap, and their autocannon just has enough punch to really mess up your opponent, especially early game. A lot of people like to get them in the early game, but they're even good late game, as you can see in this case. He took out his artillery and managed to trick his opponent into friendly firing a ton of dudes. And another thing is that it seems like those armored cars are so much better than the stationary anti-air platforms. Okay, a Panther just took out the turret of the enemy anti-air tank. That's another thing I really like about the Panther. They just feel so responsive. They're quick, and their gun is really accurate. Seems like I miss a lot of the Tiger, but the Panther gun has tight groupings even at long range. Oh no, there's a KV-85 over here. Let's see what the KV-85 does to the Panther. That would be interesting to see. But like I said, you can pay 12 points for the armored car with an autocannon, or you can pay 12 points for the autocannon by itself. And it seems like the armored car is better in every way, except it can't be recrewed. But that's pretty much the only bad thing. You can't even tow the stationary the stationary anti-air cannon. So why not give it a chassis of an armored car? Just seems stupid that they cost the same when it seems like the armored car is much better. You can get the FLAC 38 by itself, or get, was it the FLAC 38? You can get the anti-air cannon, auto cannon by itself, or you can get it mounted on the chassis of an armored car. So seems like it's a ripoff to just get the auto cannon by itself.
But it looks like the B team army is actually winning right now. I assume that's the opposing force. Oh no, I got things all wrong. The B army is the team you're spectating right now. But what was I saying? Okay, so you see a group of infantry moving up. And they don't really know what's ahead. That's where this officer comes in again. And he actually managed to detect an ambush. You see, so maybe I was wrong about the officer in the beginning. Maybe he knew that it was a good idea to get the officer because his opponent really likes to hide dudes in bushes. He could have scouted him out with infantry, but because his officer hasn't gotten killed at all in this game, it might have been well worth the cost. He just rode up a verbal wind. I don't really know why he rode up a verbal wind, because the Panzer IV E is also really good at killing infantry. And the thing of the verbal wind is that it's kind of really you're putting it's pretty much all anti-infantry, anti-light vehicles, and it can't do much against anything that's more armored than a Panzer IV. So I didn't know why he got that. And he's playing really risky with the scout. He's moving it close. I don't even know why he moved his scout up. He had an officer scouting for infantry, so I don't get the point. Unless there's something back here that I missed, like a heavy tank or something. Let's see what he's trying to do. He could have also shouted afar from the Panzer IV E. But that shows you just how stealthy the scout is. When you have it prone and crawling, enemies can't even notice it, even when it's right there. Also, when you play the scout, you gotta kind of play it the reverse of how you play infantry. When you play infantry, you want to put them in cover, put them in bushes and whatnot. In a scout, if you move it through bushes, then the ruffle will give it away, like you're seeing now. But he's getting lucky. His enemy apparently hasn't noticed that. In an open field, I prefer to have the scout just move across the open field. You don't really benefit from the bush anyway. It's not like you need that extra protection. The scout's stealthy enough that it doesn't really need the extra stealth that a bush gives you, unless you want to put the scout in the ambush position. But